us now by phone for an exclusive interview is Conagra CEO Sean Connolly. Sean, it's good to talk to you again. You and other packaged food companies are putting up these tremendous quarters of growth and forecasting more growth, and the market is just not convinced it's going to last. What do you make of the share price reaction today?
Well, obviously, I don't love it when we put up a great quarter and the stock drops, but you know, frankly, I'm focused on maximizing long-term value creation versus daily movements, and it was an excellent quarter. As you point out, we had broad-based strength and excellent fundamentals, and our consumers in frozen and elsewhere have discovered the massive innovation infusion we've launched over the past few years, and they're coming back again and again, which clearly bodes well post-COVID, but you make the good point. Food stocks have not been up even when posting strong numbers, and the market is clearly demonstrating a bit of a wait-and-see attitude toward food stocks right now. What I keep pointing out, though, is not just the absolute strength we're seeing, but the relative strength. We think that's the critical leading indicator as to who will emerge stronger.
So expand on that a little bit and try to make the case for why you see staying power in the consumer behavior changes around eating that we've seen, say, buying frozen foods, that why when the vaccine comes and we hopefully all get back to normal, we won't resume normal eating habits, which is ditching a lot of the kind of old school brands that you and others have.
Well, you know, it's an interesting question, and certainly a lot of companies have had a bit of an automatic tailwind because of COVID. But I'll point out that not all companies are performing with equal strength in trial, in repeat, and in depth of repeat. And we didn't just show up at COVID with a slate of old products. We've been transforming our portfolio for 5 years now. It has been a massive innovation overhaul. And frozen, as an example, one of the things we're experiencing within COVID is all these consumers who had an antiquated mental model of what frozen food is, they're now discovering that the frozen food quality they can get today is outstanding. It's essentially fresh food, flash frozen, but it's on call and ready when they are, and it's a great value. So it's excellent food, excellent value, and they're buying it again and again, and they're telling us, geez, this is not what I thought I was going to experience when I bought frozen. And we're seeing similar dynamics, but I'll point out an interesting fact, which is, the last time there was a significant macro, adverse macro environment in the 2008 crash, we saw sustained at-home eating occasions. But when we saw the pandemic hit, we saw a larger shift to at-home eating occasions, and we see no reason why some of that won't sustain. Because basically, the way to think about it is we believe we are experiencing an acceleration of product trial that in normal times would take years and hundreds of millions of dollars. And we have the portfolio that has been pleasing our consumers, and we're seeing them come back again and again.
How much do you need to spend then on marketing to sustain that? Are you getting this all for free because people are not being forced to experience your products, but I guess being pushed towards them somewhat? And how lasting an impact do you think you get, particularly on new consumers that might not be being reminded of your brands but be trying them for the first time?
Yeah, it's an excellent question. And one of the strange things is around our company, we're often focused on how do we generate more demand. And in the past 9 months, our focus has been how do we generate more supply. And in some cases, it hasn't made sense to invest marketing because we were simply out of capacity and our supply was that constrained because demand was so elevated. But we've built back some of our capacity. Our inventory levels are strong. And our marketing investments have been opportunistic where we have capacity, where we see strong ROIs. So as an example, one of our very modern brands is Gardein. It fits this whole new plant-based lifestyle. We've been advertising Gardein. We've seen a tremendous response. Our frozen business is growing strongly overall, but within frozen, Gardein is leading the pack. And that's really a trend that we jumped on and we got behind to help maximize it because there's a lifetime value to the consumers that we capture today given the repeat rates we're putting up.
What about Duncan Hines, Sean? How big of a growth driver is that with the at-home baking trend? And how are you capitalizing on that trend to make it more lasting?
Well, you know, you all just talked about all the money that's sitting around in the savings, but what we see is people have been investing in their homes. They're expecting to have home offices going forward. They've been investing in their kitchens. They've been investing in their appliances. And amazingly, one of our strongest categories has been the baking category. And, you know, moms and dads everywhere are seeing their sons and daughters learn how to bake, and they're cooking up a storm in the kitchen with products like Duncan Hines. So that is an example of the kind of product that you see growth in when consumers go into more of a testing mode. And so whether it's Duncan Hines or products like our Rotel tomato business, people are looking for simple meals, whether it's breakfast, lunch, dinner, or dessert. And these kinds of products are meeting that need right now. And for many of these younger consumers, they're experiencing the art of cooking for the first time, and they're liking it.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.